Well, in our last session, we took a look at the idea of what the university's greatest weapon is against biblical Christianity, and that's the idea that the Bible records are not historically reliable. And what we found is that the manuscripts, the history, and how the Bible was put together is all reliable and all trustworthy. So we're on page 21 in your manuals, and in this session, what we're going to do is take a look at thinking about how to live out our faith by not being a trout. All right, does that make perfect sense? So what's going to help you to live out your faith is to not be a trout. So I'll get this going. And page 21, as we think about this. Now, in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, Peter makes his argument that our enemy, the devil, is prowling about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. All right? Now, I don't know what goes through your mind when you think about the devil, but I'm curious if there's any person from a book that you've read, a movie that you've seen, maybe someone at your high school that comes to mind when you think of the devil? Anybody? Any character from, yeah?
Jafar from Aladdin.
Jafar from Aladdin. Ooh, very good one. Let's take that. Yes?
The White Witch.
The White Witch, Chronicles of Narnia, right.
Hades from Hercules.
Oh, we got a kind of a Disney theme going here, okay? What about 101 Dalmatians? Cruella de Vil. If she doesn't scare you, no one will. That cruel devil. What's that?
Saruman,
okay. What about in Little Mermaid? Who's the devil?
Ursula.
Ursula, I want your voice. Yeah. And what about Snow White and the Seven Dwarves? That lady with the apple. Yeah, whatever her name is. Clara or Cindy, or what was her name? The lady with the apple?
Yeah.
Yeah. And Cinderella, who's the devil character there? The stepmom, evil stepmom. Beauty and the Beast.
Gaston.
You were thinking for a moment, you're going, is it the Beast? Is it Gaston? Is it the Beast? Is it Gaston? Yeah, you're kind of going back and forth on that. Well, my favorite example is from the movie The Terminator. Now, I don't know if you've seen these older movies, but it's about these two killing machines that come and fight each other, and the new Terminator that comes back, there's no way you can stop this guy. No way. You know, he always keeps coming back. And what I think is powerful about that is the idea that the character that the Bible presents about the devil is a real person, and he's never going to give up on us. He's never going to give up on trying to mess up our relationship with Christ whatsoever. What's interesting about that picture that he prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour is, have you ever seen those clips on YouTube where you got the lions going after an animal and they're eating the animal? Who do they go after? The slowest one, the weakest one, you know, the babies, and the ones all by themselves, yeah. That's where they're hanging out. They're hanging out in the back of the pack. They're probably the delinquent lions back there smoking. You know, hey, is mom, where's mom? I don't know. You know, they're back there, whatever. But they're goofing around, you know. All right, hey, hang on. Here comes mommy. You know, they're in the back of the pack, whatever they're doing. But the devil is always going after that one. And what's interesting is you're going off to college or out of high school, and remember, you're rat boy, you're rat girl, you're all by yourself. You are being separated from the herd. And what's amazing about Satan's strategy, it's one of the oldest in the book. It's called divide and conquer. And the idea is that if you can get a person away from their support system or their support group and all by themselves, they are so much easier to conquer. Okay? So what we want to take a look at is this idea that Satan is very real and very clever in his strategy about how he's going to try to hurt and mess up your fellowship with Christ as you leave high school, okay? So we're going to look at two components for Satan's strategy, and then what we're going to do is take a look at the idea of how to develop our own strategy to avoid what he wants to do in causing a lot of chaos in our life, all right? So the first thing I want to suggest is trying to understand what his trap is, and the trap is really simple. Satan's goal is to kill your fellowship with Jesus and to get you quit walking with him. It's that easy. If the spiritual life was a video game and he's got the controller, all he has to do is get you to mess up your life, fill your life and heart with guilt and shame and make you go, this is too hard. I don't feel very close to Jesus after what I just did. And the more you do that, the more emotional distance that builds up between you and him. And you know what? Sooner or later, you can go, boy, this is too hard. I quit. And that's what the trap is. He wants to fill our life with this emotional distance to kill your fellowship and make you say, I quit. What I've left for you in your manual is three case studies. These are actual, real college students that I have worked with. Their names have been changed to protect the guilty. And what I want to do is have you look through them. But before we do that, I want us to think about what James said in chapter 1 there in your notes. When tempted, let no one say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he's dragged away and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. James is saying there's an actual progression that takes place in how we're tempted. And this process starts very innocently sometimes, but can lead us all the way down this road to where the end result is that we have died, so to speak, that there is now a death in our fellowship with God. So what I want to do is I'm going to assign different people to different tables, and I want you to read their story. So once I assign your table a person, elect one person to read the story out loud, and the rest of you just listen along. And then if you look on page 22 of your manual, what I've done is left for you a kind of a chart or a table. And I want to see if there's a way that you can chart in these people's lives the progression that James talks about. As you look at their story, was there a moment where they're dragged away and enticed? What was luring them or seducing them? What was their own evil desire? What was going on in their heart that made it easier for them to keep going? Was there a point where after desire was conceived? In other words, was there kind of a no turning back in their story that, boy, once you did that, you're kind of committed? And then lastly, what was the result? What happened in their story, in their personal life, okay? So I'm going to do this, and we're going to give you a few minutes to work on that. So let me start assigning some groups and see how this will work. So can I have this table right here be my Rob table? Well, this is the trap that Satan's trying to set for us, that all of us are going to be tempted on certain things and can go down this path. And what he's trying to do is to kill our fellowship with Jesus so we quit and we say, oh, man, I can't do this. There's a second part of his strategy, and that's the idea of giving us some bait. What is the bait that he's going to use? The bait that he uses is the idea that in college, Satan will offer you many ways to relieve the ache of unmet God-given needs. You have God-given needs for friendship, for love, for acceptance, for being involved, for community, for peace, for significance, all kinds of things that God has hardwired into you. But Satan's going to bring about counterfeit ways to get you to think that, oh, these will meet my needs. This will make me feel included. This will make me feel special. Is there anybody who's a fly fisherman or fly fisherwoman, fly fisher person in the group? Fly fishing or likes to fly fish. Okay. It's one of the things I want to get to is fly fishing. I grew up in Arizona, so my idea of fishing is like fish sticks, okay? That's about as far as I get on it, you know? And I've never caught a breaded fish. I don't know where you hunt for those ones, but anyway, my friend Bob loves to fly fish, and when he goes out, he's one of these nuts. He likes to find out exactly what the time of the year is, the time of the day, and when he's fishing, when he catches his first fish, he takes out his little fish stomach pump, shoves it down the throat of the fish, poor fish, and takes out all the contents of the fish's stomach, splats it right down there on the rock, gives the fish a little throat lozenge and puts it back in the water, you know. And then he takes his pencil and he sifts through all the stuff that was in the fish's stomach. Then what he does is he takes his box of fly fish hooks, and that's a fish hook that's wrapped with wings and threads and all that stuff that are made to look like insects. And he tries to see, is there anything in my box that matches what the fish have been feeding on that particular time of the day? Because as a fly fisherman, Bob knows that his goal is to trick the fish into thinking that this is real food. And that's exactly what Satan's strategy is. He wants to trick you into thinking that, man, going with those group of people will make you feel loved. It will make you feel accepted. Yeah, you'll be wanted, but there's a hook in it. So be aware of what his strategy is, and that he's going to say, this is something that will meet those aches that you have. But there's going to be a hook. So those are his two strategies, okay? So what can we do to escape? What are some things that we might think about? Well, the first thing is to consider in the idea of escaping his plans is to take ownership of your God-given needs and develop God-honoring boundaries to get them met. That's a fancy word of saying find God-honoring ways to get those needs met. Guys, these are your feelings of loneliness, not mine. These are your feelings of stress. These are your feelings of freedom. You've got to learn how to manage those feelings. They're all under your skin. So can you find some ways to deal with those legitimate feelings in ways that honor God and help you? I want to suggest a few, okay? So as we think about the idea of loneliness, the first thing that I want to suggest is the idea that start looking for Christian fellowship at your college right now. And we're going to talk more about that in the next session, all right? Another thing is that remember how friendships are formed. Three things: proximity, time, and fun. Who are the people that Tony hung out with? The people in his dorm, people he lived around. Who are the people that Megan hung out with? The people in her dorm. See, the people you're closest to geographically, there's a greater chance that you will kind of make them your group. The people you spend more time with, you start to feel obligated and committed. Well, I guess this is my group because we always go to dinner together, we always go to lunch together, and so on. And people you have fun with. Doesn't mean that it's wrong to have fun with other people, but I'm just saying that if you're spending a lot of time with people right near you and having a lot of fun with them, don't be surprised if they become your group and it's hard for you to get away. So think through who are the kinds of people that you want to be close to, spend time with, and have fun with. All right? And lastly, get into a small group Bible study in your dorm or wherever as soon as you can. Because aside from God, your greatest need is for God's people. What are some practical thoughts on the idea of freedom? Some things that might help you there. First of all, is to identify yourself as a Christian your first day in college. Now, I know why you wouldn't want to do that. I know you might be thinking, well, I don't want to be one of those Christians that talks all the time. I'm going to be a Christian who shows by how they walk. Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. So I'm not going to be doing this. I'm going to be doing this. But you know what? The longer you wait to prove your Christianity, the easier it is to hide your Christianity. And so what happens is that people will be incognito for a while, and then all of a sudden they start doing stuff that they shouldn't be doing, and the last thing you want to do is go, oh, by the way, I'm a Christian. They're going to go, uh-uh. So identify yourself as a Christian your first day on campus. Ask the resident assistant, hey, are there any Bible studies in this dormitory? Are there any Christian groups on my campus? Are there people from our floor that go to church? You start asking questions like that, they're going to go, oh, okay, you take your faith seriously. Maybe you can get a big WWJD pillowcase that your mom's made for you, you know, and bring it to class. Hi, how you doing, Bob? You know, that kind of thing. Or over the summer before college, make a nice big 8-foot wooden cross and just bring it into your room. Hey, Mac, how you doing? Yeah, okay. Mind if I put this over your bed? Hey, just want you to know. Straight up. So identify yourself as a Christian that first day on campus because it'll help you feel accountable and not feel like, oh, I can do whatever I want. I can become anyone I want. Next is the idea to develop or strengthen your convictions around those sins that you turn to when you feel lonely and stressful. And we're going to do that in your spiritual aptitude section. All of us have these sins that haunt us, that we go back to. Well, become aware of what is that cycle for you and how does that work. Next, find a time management tool that works for you. You've got all this free time, but you've got all this work to do, don't you? Learn how to manage your free time with your responsibilities. That will help you stay accountable that, no, I don't have just time to do anything I want. I got to get stuff done. And lastly, is to get into a small group Bible study in your dorm or whenever, as soon as you can. Because aside from God, your greatest need is for God's people. Well, there's a third practical step that I want us to think about as it relates to the whole idea of stress. And first of all is to think through, study yourself and determine what circumstances make you stressful. You know, the devil knows your motivation and mine better than we do. And there's certain triggers that make it easier for us to go down the path of certain kinds of sins. The people who work long-term with those who have really difficult struggles with alcohol and addictions and so on, they'll tell you that there's certain triggers that always kind of set people up to go and find relief for their stress. Things like when they're hungry, when they're angry, when they're lonely, when they're tired. So what are the things that go on in your life that make it easy for you to go down that path that usually winds up being destructive in your life? Understand that and find ways to get those needs met legitimately. Next, discover some healthy ways then that relieve your stress. You know, if playing Xbox relieves your stress, that's great. But if playing Xbox for 9 hours makes you more stressful, don't do that. Maybe it's going for a run. Maybe it's exercising. Maybe it's watching movies with some friends. I don't know. But what are some things that make you go, okay, I blew off some steam. Now it's time to get back to work. And the third thing is that get into a small group Bible study in your dorm or wherever as soon as you can. Because aside from God, your greatest need is for God's people. So develop some God-honoring ways to get these needs met. These are your needs. These are your feelings. How can you find ways to get those met legitimately? There's a second thing that's important about our escape, and that is to take ownership of your sin by spiritually breathing. Now, that's just like physically breathing, okay? When we physically breathe, the first thing we do is exhale. We get rid of all the carbon dioxide, the stuff our body can't use. So the idea there is to confess your sins to God. John tells us in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us all of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So be honest with God. Tell him what's going on. He already knows anyways. The second part of that then is to thank him for his forgiveness. In Colossians, we're told that when Jesus was on the cross and he looked out at our life, all of our sins were in the future. And it's not like he looked down the road and said, you know something, she's going to do something about 600 times at least. And, you know, after 600, I'm not going to stick with her. I'm not paying for anything after 600. She's on her own. Sorry. It's like, no. Every single sin that we commit to him was like, I'm dying for all of them. So come to God and say, thank you. Don't say, will you please forgive this one? Or could you maybe forgive this one? Or say, look, if you're a believer in Christ, God's given you all the forgiveness. Thank him for it. And you know what happens when you say thank you to him? You start to close that emotional distance. We feel distant from God when we sin. When we say thank you, it's a way of saying, okay, he does love me. He has committed to me. Let's keep moving. All right? Well, just like in physical breathing, we need to inhale oxygen. And what that kind of means is the idea of asking God's Spirit to empower you to follow him. God has given us his Holy Spirit to live in us to help us to become more like Christ. Okay? The Christian life is not hard, folks. It's actually impossible. There's no way you and I can be like Jesus Christ apart from his help. So ask for his Spirit to change you, to grow, to guide you as you go through this. And the third step is repeat. And this is the thing that I have seen mess up most Christians right here, is that they don't do step number three. They just don't do step number three. What I've seen in my experience is not that the students who do poorly in their faith because they've met some Marxist, Leninist, lesbian, left-handed professor that attacks their faith. It's because they get sin in their life. They're not doing well with the Lord, and they don't know how to experience their forgiveness and keep walking with him. And they don't repeat. When I got to college, I mentioned to you that I became a Christian my freshman year in college. But before I got to college, I brought this habit with me from high school. When my brother was on his paper route one time, he found this huge collection of pornography and brought it home. And we put all that stuff through our mind all through high school. And so when I come to college and become a Christian, I'm saying, God, I want you to help me have a godly understanding of what sex is and marriage is and everything. Will you help me? So I'm sitting in this library at this school down in the southwest. It's bright and it's sunny all the time. And ladies are almost wearing bikinis, it seems. And I'm in the library trying to do my work. And after about 5 minutes go by and this gal walks by, I've got these garbage thoughts in my head. So I confess those to the Lord. I say, thank you. I say, will you help me with your Spirit to just stay focused? So I go back to homework. Another gal walks by. And I get more garbage thoughts. And I go, well, Lord, thank you for my forgiveness. I confess that to you. Thank you. Help me with your Spirit to just really stay focused. Another 5 minutes goes by. Another garbage thought. Okay, Lord, I say, confess that. Thank you. Ask for your help. Okay. Another 5 minutes, same thing. You know what happens after about 30 minutes? I am sick and tired of this. Because the more I practice this, the more I realize, man, I'm a sinner. I really need some help. And if you don't commit yourself to continue to repeat and continue to come to Christ and say, man, I need your forgiveness, thank you, thank you. You'll let that all build up and build up and build up, and all this guilt and all this shame will build up in your heart till one day it just goes, boom, I quit. I can't do this. I can't fake it anymore. So we've got to learn how to repeat. That's an important part of this escape mechanism. When 9/11 happened, it was one of these things that was really surreal because it was like, gosh, who are these people? What are they trying to do? I remember we watched it on the news. We were like, gosh, is this a movie set? What's going on? It was just horrible to think that people would do this kind of thing. When commentators began to look and study who these people were and what they did and why, they began to notice things like, wow, these people have tried this before. About 9 years earlier, they tried to blow up the same two buildings, but they filled a van with dynamite, drove it down to the bottom of the parking garage, set off an explosion, hoping that the towers would fall over like trees. But that didn't work. And as people learned more about the story, they said, wow, these people are really pretty smart for what they did. They're actually pretty clever. Some even said they were even geniuses for what they did and how they did it. They didn't agree with it, but how they did it. Because they began to realize that if you could somehow set off an explosion in the heart of the building, that the fire and the heat from that would compromise the integrity of the metal structures, and the building would collapse in the heart of it, and gravity would do the rest of the work. But they were smart enough to know that you can't fill a van with dynamite, drive it into a lobby, take it to the middle on the elevator. There'd be some bright security rent-a-cop saying, hey, pal, move that van of dynamite out of here, will you? You know? But they said, you know what you can do? Is you can take an airplane filled with thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of gallons of jet fuel that's bound for the West Coast, and you can drive it into the heart of the building, and you can set off an explosion that will burn and burn and burn for a long time, that will get really hot, that will compromise the metal, and the structure will collapse, and gravity pull it down. Do you know how long it took to build the Twin Towers from planning to finish? About 20 years to build those two buildings. Do you know how long it took for each one to fall? 10 seconds. Because the weight of carrying all of that made them collapse. And that's what I've seen knocked out Christians in college, is they don't know how to manage their sin. They don't know how to walk in the forgiveness that God's given them. And they carry all this weight and all this burden of guilt and shame, and they finally just quit. They say, I don't want to do this anymore. And I don't want that to happen to you. I want to give you a moment to look at your spiritual aptitude test. And this is the longest one in the whole manual, and I know you're not going to get time to finish it all. But it's going to ask you some very personal questions about these areas of sin in your life. And it's designed to kind of help you get an inventory to say, how am I doing with this? How am I doing with that? To make you more aware of what's going on. So I encourage you to be as honest as you can, because you're only going to help yourself find where there might be some weak areas or some sloppy thinking or maybe things you just have questions about. But I want you to walk through this. I'll give you at least about 5 minutes. You're not going to cover everything. Some things are too personal that you don't want to cover in front of other friends. But I hope you'll get a view for what kinds of questions they are so that you can come back, you can spend some time with these questions and with the Lord and really think through these things and figure out what you believe and think about this before you go into this environment. So I'll give you about 5 minutes, and then we'll take a turn. Well, I wish we had time for you to get all the way through that. You can tell it's pretty pointed. So I hope it's giving you some things to think about and a way of just being honest with yourself and with God to see where you're at. And maybe you can come back to it and finish it and do a little bit more thinking and a little more reflecting. So, well, Satan is very real and very clever in his strategy about how he wants to mess up our Christian life. And we've seen that what he wants to do is parade counterfeit options in front of us, thinking that these choices will really meet the God-given needs that we have. We also have seen the idea that God wants us to learn how to walk in the forgiveness that we have in Christ. And that's what I really want for you all. When you go off to college, I don't want you to be a trout. I want you to see that hook clearly and walk away and say, I'm going to find legitimate ways to get these needs met and walk with God in the midst of that. Well, in our next session, what we're going to take a look at is the idea that God has given us one very, very powerful thing to help us to walk with Him.